ये अपने पास रखे। मैं गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन, अ वेरी वॉर्म वेलकम टू दिस वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग एंड इम्पोर्टेंट सीएमई ऑन पीपीएच। पीपीएच एज आई थिंक आई डोंट नीड टू से, एवरीबडी नो इट इज वन ऑफ द वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट कॉज ऑफ मटर्नल मोर्टेलिटी एंड नॉट ओनली मोर्टेलिटी, द मॉर्बिडिटी ऑफ पीपीएच इज ऑल्सो वेरी हाई। द मदर हैज टू रिमेन इन हॉस्पिटल फॉर ए लॉन्ग टाइम, शी इज नॉट एबल टू ब्रेस्ट फीड हर बेबी फॉर सम टाइम, एंड वेन देर इज ए मोर्टेलिटी नॉट ओनली द मदर सफर्स, इवन द फैमिली सफर्स। And we have with us today, you know, very distinguished faculty. Especially, we have our chief guest, Dr. Mitra, who is the chair of obstetric committee. Can I have her CV, please? And we have Dr. Sanjeevani, Dr. Jyotsna, Dr. Jyoti Bhaskar, Dr. Meenakshi, you know, who have all, you know, they are stalwarts in this field of obstetric. So Dr. Mitra is the chairperson of practical obstetric committee and a very dear friend. She is a senior obstetric obs and gynae in private practice in Rewari, Haryana, and I think everybody knows her. She is very very active, and she is conducting some very good programs all over India, and
Thank
she
you.
is
Thank you,
the
Dr. That's so
convener
nice.
of Project Director Mukti. And she's a member of many, you know, societies, and her area of interest is high risk obstetrics, especially. That's why she was very keen to be the chair of this committee because she really wanted to do work. And I'm very happy that she accepted this invitation to, you know, be present at a webinar on PPH. Over to you, Dr. Mitra, for some words from you.
As a very good evening to all my friends, to Dr. Achla Batra, President of AOGD, a very, very close friend. And of course, all my seniors, Dr. Sanjeevani Khanna is here. And I'm actually blessed that I am here with you people. And I think PPH is something which we don't even wish for our enemies, because the dread and the heartache and the tachycardia which obstetrician suffers, we are very kind human beings. We don't like our colleagues to suffer. And so I think that AOGD, actually, I'm very happy and proud to share it that Rewari is a small branch, which was, you know, we made it in 2002, but I was a member of AOGD. And this is a society which I really want to remain, would you say, additional member all my life, because the wonderful work every team of AOGD does, and in keeping with the trend of all the past teams, our present team is doing wonders on the web digital forum. And I think PPH is one topic. जितनी बार भी सुन लो उतनी बार ही रिविजन क्लास बहुत जरूरी है. इट्स लाइक अ रेडी रेकनर. तो एनी वेयर एवरी वेयर वेर पीपीएच इज बींग डिस्कस्ड, ऑल ऑफ अस शुड बी रियली अटेंटिव. एंड नोइंग दैट ऑल द सीनियर्स हु आर हियर टू गिव देयर एक्सपर्ट कमेंट्स एंड द स्पीकर्स and the things that are going to be discussed today, they are very, very relevant. And yes, we all know that the eminent faculty which is here, they're all, you know, masters in their techniques. And whenever in times of stress, any one procedure, for example, the technique of using a tamponade, balloon tamponade, or a condom tamponade, at that particular moment, it is like a lifesaver. So I think I will invite all the participants to be very vigilant and attentive so that any queries, if they have, we can have a very good interaction. Over to the conduct of the scientific session today. And my best wishes. I'm going to be here till throughout so that I can always, you know, sharpen my revision class of PPH. Thank you, Dr. Achila. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Dr. Mitra. And I see Dr. Sajini has also joined, who is a, you know, like a teacher to me, because I was her house surgeon, and that is the time you learn. She was a PG, and she really taught me. So welcome, Sanjeevani. And
And
now I.
I just want to tell you, Dr. Achla, that I met Dr. Sanjeevani somewhere in Faridabad many, many years ago. Ma'am was the faculty, she was taking some talk, and we both happened to cross each other in the toilet, sorry. But when I looked at this personality, so beautiful, so elegant, she was such a, you know, wonderful combination of.
She's still elegant and beautiful.
And I became a fan of Dr. Sanjeevani. And it has been over 20 years, I think. And I'm so blessed.
Thank you so much, Dr. Mitra. And I think, Achala, it's all thanks to you that, you know, somehow that link and the bond with AUGD is becoming our bond in Delhi with each other, and even outside Delhi, it's becoming so strong because we know each other for decades now. So yeah. We value each other as much as you are speaking about me, and I'm so grateful to Achala and Mitra both. I'd like to say that I'm getting along because of you all. I'm moving along because of you all. I'm working because of you all. And I'm not ever disillusioned because I know I have you as my friend. Thank you.
Yeah. The poetess of Sanjeevani. Okay, over to the, you know, MOCs of this session to start the meeting, please.
Good evening, everyone, all my respected seniors. And it was very truly said by Dr. Mitra Saxena, jitna padh lenge PPH ke bare mein utna hi kam jante. So I think it was very aptly said. And PPH, as defined by WHO, contribution to 5% of the maternal mortality, and even in it's mainly higher in countries like South Africa and India. And the main part, how vigilant we are about recognizing PPH and managing it. So with this, I would like to start the session based on preparedness of PPH. And I would like to share my screen. Is my screen visible?
Yes, it's visible.
Firstly, I would like to welcome Dr. Jyoti Bhaskar, who is the chairperson, who is the person of our, who is the for our first talk. She is an obstetric and gynecologist at Apollo Cradle Hospital in Indirapuram, Delhi, NCR. And she's presently the Prezi, and she's the co-chairperson, AOGD Subcommittee on Quality Improvement, Secretary of Delhi Chapter of Indian Menopausal Society, and she's a member representative of RCOG and ZL in RCOG UK. And she's received the President Gold Medal for standing first in Delhi University, APG Abdul Kalam Appreciation Award by DGF 2016, Chikitsa Vishisht Award by IMA East 2016, Teacher of the Teachers Award from DGF in 2017. And she has been a speaker, chairperson, and panelist at various national and international conferences. Secondly, I would like to welcome Dr. Sanjeevani Khanna. She is the Director and Head Department of Obs and Gynae at Fortis Hospital, Shalimar Bagh at New Delhi. She was formerly former Professor, Department of Obs and Gynae at LHMC and Srimati SK Hospital, New Delhi. She's the Chairperson, Delhi Gynecologist Forum North, and she's the Vice President, Indian Association of Gynecological Endoscopists, Delhi Chapter 2021-2023. Welcome, respected seniors. And I would like to now hand over the presentation to you, ma'am.
So, good evening, everyone. And a real sincere thanks to Dr. Achala, Dr. Jyotsna, Dr. Monica, and the whole team of the AOGD for having me today over here. So, if you really look at what exactly is the theme of the AOGD conference, which is there in November, that is safe practices and quality services. And the basics of this safe practices is a clinical audit. And that is what is the first lecture that we are going to have. It's about clinical audit. And what is clinical audit? It's the most powerful safety monitoring technique. And it is the most powerful quality improvement process. And the ultimate aim of an audit is not to fix blames, but is to improve the patient care and the outcomes. And this is what Dr. Sheba is going to talk about, the quality audit in PPH. And I would like to introduce Dr. Sheba, if I could have her CV, please. So Dr. Sheba is an associate professor in the Department of Obs and Gynecology at Safdarjung Hospital. She's the co-editor of the AUG Bulletin of 21-22, a coordinator for VMMC and Safdarjung Hospital's Delhi PG Forum. She is a member of the AOGD Gynae Oncology Committee, a chairperson of the Menstrual Disorders Committee's Society of Menstrual Disorders and Health Management. She's a member of the FOCSI Young Talent Promotion Committee, FOCSI Quiz Committee, a COVID-19 nodal officer for the Department of Obs and Gynae from March 2020 to April 2021. She's got many, many laurels, many publications, a lot of research work to her credit. At this young age, she has achieved what many of us would have dreamed at that particular age to achieve. And she indeed is a huge asset to the Department of Obs and Gynae and Safdarjung Hospital. So Dr. Sheba, over to you.
Thank you, Ajman, for giving me this opportunity. And
Sheba, I would like you to introduce your MOC also. I forgot to do that. These young girls are doing very good work.
Yes, ma'am. Our Masters of Ceremony today is Dr. Shivani. Dr. Shivani Verma, she's a post-PG resident of Safdarjung Hospital in Department of Obs Gynae. And the question and answer session will be done by Dr. Priyanka Pante. She's also the post-PG senior resident in Department of Obs Gynae at Safdarjung Hospital. Welcome, Shivani, and welcome, Priyanka. Thank you, Jyoti ma'am, for that kind introduction. And thank you, Achla ma'am, once again for giving me this opportunity to talk about a topic which is very important and very pertinent. And as all have already highlighted, the more we study and more we read about PPH, it just seems that we still have a long way to go. Are my slides visible?
Yes, ma'am.
So I'm going to talk about quality audit in postpartum hemorrhage. The slides are not moving.
Put it on slideshow, Dr. Shiva.
Yes.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Then it will move.
Yes, ma'am. So my topic is quality audit in postpartum hemorrhage. So what is quality care? The quality of care is the degree to which health services for individuals and populations increase the likelihood of desired health outcomes and care consistent with current professional knowledge. It has to be safe, effective, efficient, timely, equitable, and people-centered care. Maternal mortality, as we all know, is a global tragedy, with over 99% of it occurring in the developing world. And India is no far away, with 12% of the global maternal deaths occurring alone in India. Though we have seen a healthy decline of around 3.5% decrease in maternal mortality per year since 2010, yet we are a long way to go to achieve our target of 70 per lakh as set by the SDG. It is said that if you want to know how strong a country's health system is, just look at the well-being of its mothers. And that's why these SDGs were compiled with a target of 70 per lakh live births, but to be achieved by 2030. So what are pregnant women dying from? Various causes have been enlisted, and unfortunately, hemorrhage is still the leading cause. As by the FIGO data, it constitutes around 27.1% of maternal deaths all across the world. In India, it's even worse, with hemorrhage causing around 35% of maternal deaths, and it becomes the forerunner of the deadly triad of maternal mortality, with hypertension and sepsis being the other correlates. Various definitions of PPH have been given by different organizations depending upon the blood loss, the WHO, the SOGC, the ACOG, and then the RCOG. They all divide blood loss as minor PPH, major PPH, moderate PPH, severe PPH, and then California Maternity Quality of Care Collaborative has also differentiated. Now, maternal mortality is just the tip of iceberg, and there is a vast tip of base to this iceberg which remains undescribed. And for this, there comes the role of near-miss. There is a continuum of care which is, if faulted at any point, any normal woman can acquire that morbidity, deteriorate fast, become a near-miss, and even die. Thus, the concept of maternal EMS came in vogue as an adjunct and proxy measure to identify gaps in these health services and act as complementary to maternal mortality. PPH management, a lot of brainstorming has been done. We have to assess the blood loss, we have to arrest the blood loss, we have to replace the blood loss, which will be dealt with by our subsequent speaker. And many confidential inquiries have been done, which have often led us that either too little was done or it was done too late. So the golden hour, the importance still is emphasized upon. So women, they die from PPH because they do not receive early, effective and aggressive life-saving treatments. The types of delays in PPH. The first delay is in deciding to seek the medical help for an obstetric emergency by a person who is delivering at home. The second delay is that in reaching the appropriate health facility once she has made the decision. And the third delay is receiving appropriate timely care once she arrives at a facility, a particular facility. And in case she's been further referred, there is a fourth delay in timely referral as well. Now, can morbidity due to PPH be prevented? Yes, 93% of all hemorrhage-related deaths are considered potentially preventable. And if we identify any of the delays which are happening, and we can easily prevent the maternal mortality. Various guidelines have been there in vogue for rapid identification and treatment of hemorrhage in PPH, which will be dealt by the subsequent speaker. But there is the basic need of the hour becomes the quality audit. Why this audit is important? Because most of the patients who are dying, The risk factors are not reported. There are incomplete and inappropriate data. The lack of precise knowledge and relative importance of comorbidities is still lacking. We have to identify the gaps and breakdowns, and need for making national policies and revising them is very important. So the modifiable factors that often contribute to PPH have been the perceived or real negative provider attitude by the doctors, shortage of staff or high workload and lack of supportive supervision as is seen in public hospitals, poor infrastructure like water, electricity, lack of equipment, medicines and supplies, which definitely is there in the PHCs, the poor road network and other communication networks, especially for the patients who are being referred, and lack of robust learning and reporting systems. The system issues are very important because they're interconnected relationships of people and institutional policies and are a root cause in over 80% of the cases. So quality and safety, how are they related? If we improve the quality of care, we decrease the unsafe care and the best possible outcome is achieved and health satisfaction is there. So road to patient safety in obstetrics leads to safe motherhood, and this can only be done by quality improvement. And keeping that in mind, the World Patient Safety Day in September 2021 had the theme of safe maternal and newborn care, keeping the overview of the Global Patient Safety Action Plan in consideration. So characteristics of a good quality measure, all of us know. The interventions for safe and maternal health, the first pillar is the attitude, which we all need to change. And then come the three pillars, the infrastructure, the trained human resources, and the evidence-based updated protocols targeted to PPH with quality improvement. And these all come in the paradigm of the WHO quality of care framework, maternal and newborn health care. There are various approaches to improve the obstetric safety, which lie at the individual level, the group level, and the structural level. So the five components of the health care in PPH, which I'm going to concentrate today one by one, is first is the access to health services, the insurance in cases of private patients, the transportation, the wait times, the delays, language problems, cultural competencies. The second are the structural problems, the health systems, the facilities, the equipment credentials. The third is the process. The process indicators are the tests, the treatments, and the procedures. The fourth is the patient experience. And the fifth is the ultimate outcome, the health outcomes and the patient satisfaction. So the access measures, access to care is the attainment of timely and appropriate health care by patient or enrollment of healthcare organization or clinician. Now steps in the quality audit, they often target the three interventions, the structural target standards, the process target standards, and the outcome measures. And the patient's experience, which is often neglected, is extremely important in this quality improvement because these are the report of observations and participation in healthcare or assessment of any resulting change in a patient's health. These measures are determined from patient survey, whether the patient was evaluated by the provider, whether she was able to communicate, whether the patient would recommend the practice to a friend, etc. So usually 8 to 10 standards, one for each WHO quality of care framework domain are set up. 2 or 3 quality statements per standard are put over, and then quality measures are done considering the input, the output, and the outcome. So how do we implement this cycle? This cycle the main crux is the Plan, Do, Study, Act, the PDSA cycle. And this is a continuum process. It has to continuously be done and measure the quality of care and outcomes and refine strategies for scaling up a health system. So for implementation considerations, we need to update the clinical guidance of PPH. We develop or revise existing clinical guidelines, protocols, job aids, equip health facilities, ensure necessary supplies, equipping staff to use uterotonic safely, support behavioral change, obtain technical support for implementation, engage stakeholders and partners, and provide training. We also use quality certified uterotonics. Regulatory procurement and logistic progresses that work are also required. Cold chain transport and storage must be ensured for heat-sensitive uterotonics like oxytocin and ergometrin. And effective communication is quite pivotal as it ensures women that they are informed of risks, benefits, and alternatives. So this model, based upon this PDSA model, the safety bundle of PPH was formed with the 4 R's, the readiness, the recognition, the response, and reporting and review. So the quality audit cycle in PPH, how is it done? We quantify the blood loss. We should be able to stratify the patients as per her high risk. Maternal warning signs should be noted. Transfusion therapy should be available with the protocols. PPH management should be there. Everyone should be well versed with it. Team debriefing is very important. And again, simulation based trainings, that is the drills. So this for the 4 R's, they continue. That is the readiness, the recognition, the response, and ultimately the reporting and review to improve our cycle. So quality statement regarding to PPH, women with at risk are identified. Women who are at risk of having PPH are timely intervened with so that they prevent occurrence of PPH. And those who have PPH, they receive promptly the appropriate interventions. So the quality measures are that up-to-date clinical protocols for hemorrhage management are available in the childbirth and postnatal care areas and consistent with WHO guidelines. Health facilities should have uterotonics and supplies for IV fluid and blood administration available throughout the year. A functional blood transfusion service should be available in the health facility at all times. Healthcare staff in the labor, childbirth, and postnatal care areas should be there, and they should receive training and regular refreshing sessions in management of PPH, and this should be done once every 1 year. The quality measures, that is the output or the process. The proportion of all women with PPH in a health facility who receive therapeutic uterotonic drugs. The proportion of all women in health facility with PPH due to retained placenta for whom MRP was performed by a skilled birth attendant. These measures, they can always, based upon the WHO criteria, they can be tailored to a particular organization and set up for a particular department. The quality measures, that is the outcome. The proportion of all women who had PPH in the health facility who died because of PPH. This is our ultimate goal because we need to prevent this. The proportion of all women who gave birth in the health facility by C-section who received a blood transfusion. The proportion of all women who gave birth vaginally in the health facility who received a blood transfusion. The proportion of all women who gave birth in the health facility with severe PPH or those who experienced MNM, that is the maternal near miss due to PPH. So coming to the 4 R's, the consensus bundle on obstetric hemorrhage, which forms the basis, basic crux for quality improvement in PPH, the readiness, the recognition, prevention, response, and reporting. So these four domains, they embody 13 key elements, which are very important. Coming to the readiness, every unit must have a hemorrhage cart with supplies, checklist, instruction cards for IU balloons and compression stitches. Immediate access to hemorrhage medication should be there. Establish a response team, establish massive and emergency release transfusion protocol, and unit education on protocols, unit-based drills should be there. Role of protocols in obstetric hemorrhage cannot be understated because it has seen that they are developed, and a patient safety bundle is a set of these straightforward evidence-based recommendations for practice to improve outcomes. So the patient should be screened, they should be triaged, high risk should be taken, shock index, NEWO scoring, these are all useful for triage and monitoring. Assessment of blood loss should be done accurately, for which various aids are given: visual estimation of blood loss, the blood mats, the brass weed drape, and then Kelly's pad for quick assessment of blood loss in diagnosing patients with PPH. Then improving on current treatments, like those who fail on medical treatment, they should have the different modifications of the balloon tamponade, the Chhattisgarh tamponade, the components of PPH tray, which differ from each and every institution, but the basic components remain the same, and they should be available along with the presence of the emergency crash cart. The condom catheter, the Chhattisgarh catheter, or the Bakri balloon catheter. If the patient needs to be referred, the aortic compression should be taught, and then there is use of the NASG and the Lardell compression bed while referring the patient. every tertiary facility should have a massive transfusion protocol algorithm displayed, which is mandatory. Emergency PPH mock drills should occur. The drills, they help the participating members by assigning them tasks and responsibilities necessary to run the drills. And post-drill debriefings provide an invaluable opportunity to learn from the experience, discuss areas in need of improvement, share lessons learned, and highlight the system issues to allow for concrete planning for potential solutions. PPH education modules are available online also in this COVID pandemic. Self-paced modules are there. They enhance team training and everyone gets a certificate of completion. Implementation of simulation programs is very important. It requires clinician and nursing leadership, administrative and logistic support, consensus of curriculum components, gap and barrier analysis, financial support from the insurer as well, and creation of dashboards and tracking program performance, because that is most important. If we do not track, we don't know where we are going and how can we improve. Another concern with using simulation training is the retention skills. Not every provider learn in the same way or at the same rate, and to achieve maximal benefit, some individualization of simulation training is required. It is important for annual training of everyone for PPH, and those who are unsuccessful 3 weeks after training should be the remedial purpose and be followed more closely to ensure retention of skills. The second consensus part of the consensus bundle is the recognition and prevention. Again, that will be dealt in detail by the subsequent speaker. Assessment of hemorrhage risk, measurement of cumulative blood loss, and active management of third stage of labor. Again, the high risk and the low risk patients, the assessment of blood loss is done using different scores, and recognition of PPH has been done timely. This is an example of the quality improvement initiative for obstetric hemorrhage management given by US, where maternal safety bundle checklist was there, where highest priority was given to the hemorrhage protocol, the availability of equipment, and the universal use of active management of third stage of labor, apart from reinforcing learning and team performance. The third and the fourth are the response and the reporting and system review. The response of every hemorrhage, the unit standard stage-based obstetric hemorrhage plan should be available with every department with checklist and support program for patients, families, and staff. This is very important because this is often a neglected thing in most of the institutions. Then reporting and system learning from every unit should also be done, where multidisciplinary review of serious hemorrhages for system issues, establishing a culture of huddles for high-risk patients and post-event briefing, and monitoring the outcomes and process metrics in perinatal quality improvement. So the response time in PPH is very low, and depending upon the department protocols, the response should be initiated to not prevent the patient from deteriorating within the first golden hour, which can be vary from 20 to 60 minutes. Now, timely support program for patients, families, and staff, as I already said, that women and their families need timely information, reassurance, and opportunities to discuss the incident with the maternity care provider, and briefs, huddles, and debriefs, they need to be a routine in every department. Failures in teamwork and communication account for 70% of the sentinel events in obstetrics. That's why ACOG and IOM, it highlights the importance of and gives great emphasis on team learning, team management, multidisciplinary approach, and debriefing and briefing. So it says that the core concepts of team training is communication, situation monitoring, mutual support, and leadership. And the last is the review. The review, which is again done as per which setup you are working in it. But multidisciplinary review of serious incidents should be done formally to identify system issues or breakdowns that influence the outcome of the event. And all should be recorded with event timeline and focused root cause analysis should be done. The audits could be facility-based MDSR audits, the M&M audits, the referral audits, or others like the obstetric hemorrhage performers. These can be used to disseminate the findings, and response or solutions can be sought for. So there are various performers which are available. Again, the monitoring outcomes and process metrics is very important because we need to achieve our overall goal, that is to reduce the number of obstetric hemorrhages that escalate into major blood loss, resulting in severe maternal morbidity or mortality. The last concept, the last component of the WHO paradigm was that is women satisfied with the services? Well, this is again very important, as I already highlighted, because maternal satisfaction with any process is very important. Now, what are we doing? I would just like to give a brief overview at what is being done in the Department of Obstetrics and Subgyn Hospital, focusing on quality. We are following the Lakshya guidelines in the labor room, and refresher training on PPH is being done by Dr. Achala ma'am herself. And we are also empowering our providers for improved MNH care during institutional deliveries by following the Dakshata training in our skill labs. The skill lab training is being done. We have all the mannequins for the same. And we have the displayed protocols all over in the labor room with the visual estimation of blood loss and the uterotonics and how to assess the blood loss and how do you replace the blood loss timely. The PPH tray is there and everyone is being trained for it. We have facility-based maternal death reviews which are being done weekly and monthly as well. Now, learning from others' experience. A lot of studies have been done, and recent studies like in this one, which was done in Ethiopia, because it has the highest maternal mortality rate of 401 maternal deaths per lakh live births. It showed that the quality audit in PPH created awareness, resulting in self-reflection of current practice and promoted a sense of responsibility to improve care among health hospital staff. The deficiencies in case of no documentation, clinical monitoring, non-availability of medical sources, and blood for transfusion were identified, and delays in clinical management were identified, which were later on rectified. Another study in Thailand, it showed that medical records were reviewed considering the checklist of indicators for district and referral levels. It showed that the use of indwelling bladder catheter and hemodynamic monitoring was significantly increased in post-intervention period of this quality cycle. And the quality of care for PPH improved after this implementation by the healthcare providers. Again, another study done in Wales, it showed that measurement of blood loss was the most important early change in practice while PPH documentation continued to be embedded. So combining qualitative and quantitative measures to inform implementation has improved project delivery and allowed teams to adapt to local context. Another study which was done way back in 2007 in the UK, obstetric skill drills evaluation of teaching methods, it highlighted that simulation-based training is an appropriate proactive approach to reduce errors and risks in obstetrics when it actually happens. And this improves teamwork and communication whilst giving the student a multiplicity of transferable skills to improve their performance. Thus, simulation technique-based training for skilled and unskilled birth attendants is now being emphasized upon to perform bimanual uterine compression as PPH obstetric first aid, and it leads to improved applied procedural skills. So quality of care in PPH, it's a long way to go, but we need to focus on all the targets and we need to go. And then there are many research projects which are also undergoing because we need to continue this cycle of plan, do, study and act and should not stop at any time because our goal is healthy mother and healthy babies. And saving mothers' lives, we agree that patient-centered and self-care of the mother and child enhance quality and is a primary priority. Ensure the quality of obstetric care is a priority that guides individual and team decisions. So PPH being the significant cause of maternal morbidity and mortality, the specific approaches that have been considered to enhance obstetric patient safety are the checklist, the protocols, the simulation training, and the teamwork. The critical elements being the successful implementation of the PDSA program, which has to be ongoing. The teamwork and communication should be emphasized upon. Facility readiness should be there. Network integration should be done, especially for people who are doing private practice or they must engage into group practice. They should develop a network to know when and where to refer. Data monitoring and quality improvement is very essential. Role of reflective learning also comes in vogue as we must learn from our mistakes and leadership beckons. So safe maternal care, every woman counts, and together everyone achieves more. So that's all from the quality cell of Sub-Regional Hospital. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sheba. I think you have very, again, really impressed with your presentation. You have considered every aspect of it. And I know you, because of constraint of time, you had to go a little fast. It is not necessary to reiterate everything that you have covered. In fact, it's impossible to because you've taken up all aspects of quality audit. And what I'd like to say is that postpartum hemorrhage is a condition which severe morbidity and mortality is preventable in at least 50% of cases. So this is definitely an auditable condition. And Dr. Sheba has already described what auditable standards we can take in PPH. So it seems like one topic, but the standards you can follow and analyze are tremendous. So you may have small audits of a few things taken together, like and whether the PPH was recognized within 15 minutes, whether an oxytocin was given prophylactically, and so on. So you can take each of, say, five topics and do an audit on that. And for an audit, you need a guideline. And if you're having an internal audit within your hospital, then you'll take one or two or three guidelines, and your own committee will sit down and see what you want to follow. And then that will be implemented, and the whole process, that audit cycle that you have told us about. And after that, after analyzing results of this, then you will implement the changes and then do what is called a re-audit. So re-audit is going to tell you that how much for the better have we improved. I just wanted you to throw light on one thing, that do you think that just doing a quality audit is enough to bring about a change? So what should we do, Shiva? We've done an audit. Yes, we found that it's not, there were deficiencies in many areas. So, I mean, what do we do to make sure that improvements come up?
And doing an audit is just a way to recognize what are the deficiencies and where we are failing. But actual improvement in the quality of care comes when we make changes and recommendations on the basis of what we have assessed. We give a time period, we define it, because these recommendations, any recommendations, then take minimum of around 6 weeks, and we must for implementation of that change. And then after 6 weeks, or maybe 3 months, 6 weeks to 3 months, we must review the audit. So this PDSA cycle, it has to continue. And then we must measure the goals which we set depending upon our first audit. Have we able to achieve them or not?
So at the beginning itself, you set a team with the one lead person, and then have a multifaceted approach to it, like multidisciplinary, which is essential, because you may need blood bank cooperation, nurses cooperation. You'll have to see all logistics are met, and so that you have explained already. Now, one more point, and the last one perhaps, and that is that there are some types of audit. So there's one audit which is a continuous audit. Continuous audit is usually carried out in banks and all. So they're constantly auditing. What we do is an interrupted process, and then suggest changes, implement. But there, the banks and some other places, they're doing a concurrent audit and analysis and concurrent changes in recommendations. So that's one thing, that there's something called a concurrent audit or a continuous audit. And there's one more thing, and that is that there's this what you're talking about is an internal audit. But there's something called an external audit. So if there is, like, example, suppose there is a no quality improvement with your suggested changes, they're not being followed for whatever reason. And then you may have an external audit being ordered. And in that, the guidelines are also external. The people are also external, and you have less control over it. So the best possible audit would be an internal, interrupted one with suggestions in a situation of PPH. So take internal audits seriously, and mark people for it who will go through the guidelines and see which guidance is the best, and have protocol and checklists available in the labor room and wherever else necessary. And take cooperation of all multi-specialty, super-specialty people, and do a lot of homework on it, and follow it up every single day while the audit continues, and then see, I have the results analyzed, and then complete the cycle, and then re-audit. And so if you want to keep the matter internal and under your control, then it's better to be very serious and earnest. And we are short staffed, but some doctors, some nurses, from their duty hours should be given time for audit. They should be given time from their duty hours to do the audit, because it's a huge responsibility. And that's what's going to help us reach the goal of 70 maternal deaths per lakh population by 2030. So let's look at this audit. Quality audit is a very important topic, and it should never get diluted with our main discussion of the main clinical subject. So Dr. Jyoti, would you like to add something? That's what came to my mind.
No, it's a very difficult topic, madam, and she's done very beautifully. But all I would say is that the embrace, that is a UK maternal mortality. That is the biggest audit that we have seen. Actually, every year they come out, they base the guidelines on that, they implement that, and they do a re-audit. And the last one that has come in 2020, the latest one, despite auditing from 1985, they have all the reports coming. They still say that 50% of the deaths could still have been averted or changed if there was certain change in the way it is done. So it's an ongoing process. It's a difficult process. But yes, we need to move ahead with a lot of hope and a fixed goal that, yes, we are going to do that. So thank you so much.
I think actually in our country, there's so much of diversity in the way the services are delivered, from government setups, private players, and then individual single owner person. And we all know that the amount of work that the Indian obstetricians do is phenomenal, yet we do not give the data. You know, the documentation is so inadequate, I should say. So I think, you know, these talks and audit is like, I have a very small setup and very few patients as compared to the data, I mean, the number of patients which all the bigger hospitals have. But I think this applies to smallest of units and to the largest of, you know, departments. So because it stays the same. So the only way to realize that where we are making a mistake is to do an audit, to see the non-conformity. And actually, you know, all these accreditations, the NABH or the ISO, et cetera, they also actually are teaching the same things, that you should have a plan, do it, document it, and then keep doing it. So I think very nice inputs by Dr. Sanjeevani and Dr. Jyoti and Dr. Sheba. There is a wonderful comment for you by Dr. Surjeet, that Sheba has made a capsule of thousands of granules to be swallowed at one time. Well, it was a fantastic overview of everything, all the arms of PPH. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. So we close this, the first presentation, and over to Dr. Shivani or Dr. I didn't catch the second name for the next talk.
Ma'am. This is Dr. Priyanka.
Oh, Priyanka. Yes, please. Over to you.
Yes, ma'am. Good afternoon to one and all. We are going on with the question answer session now. So the first question, there are two questions in the chat box. The first one is, how do we stay prepared for PPH management? It's mostly covered by Shiva ma'am already.
Yeah, and isn't Dr. Monica going to be talking about that?
Yes,
yeah, I think so.
And the next question is, how do we anticipate a massive obstetric hemorrhage? I think even that will be covered, ma'am.
I think both the questions would be covered by Monica, so we can go ahead with the second session.
Okay, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Sheba, and Dr. Sanjeevani and Dr. Jyoti Bhaskar for the illuminating discussion on quality auditing PPH, which is an important aspect in healthcare, and especially since WHO's this year's theme is patient safety and safety of maternal mother and the newborn. So it was an amazing presentation. Thank you, ma'am. Now I would like to introduce the next speakers, the next chairpersons for our next topic. Our first chairperson for the talk is Dr. Jyotsna Suri. She's a professor, obstetrics and gynecology, and in charge of obstetric critical care at VMMC and Safdarjung Hospital. She's vice president, AOGD 2021-2022. She's national corresponding editor of Jogi 2021-23 and chairperson Safe Motherhood Committee AOGD for 2019-21. Welcome, Dr. Jyotsna Suri, ma'am. The next chairperson for the talk is Dr. Meenakshi Ahuja. She's director at Fortis La Femme, obstetrician, gynecologist, and cosmetic gynecologist. She's president, Indian Menopause Society, Delhi, academic secretary, Delhi Gynae Forum. She has been past president DGFS, speaker at FOXI, AOFOG and public forums, and she's very passionate about women's health and disease prevention. And she's a member of the multidisciplinary committee at ALGD and also the quality improvement committee at ALGD. And she's a member of the reproductive endocrinology at FOXI. So over to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much. So coming to the topic now that we have, that how well are we prepared in PPH? I think here we all have discussed that PPH is the leading cause of maternal morbidity and mortality. And it is extremely stressful for us gynecologists also. And so here in this case, I would believe that having information, having knowledge, and having the probably all the armamentarium available to us at that time, you know, and being sharp enough to use it is definitely going to help us with PPH. And when PPH occurs, that's a different story entirely, which I think will be discussed in the next topic. But also the importance is how to prevent PPH. There are a lot of drugs that we've been using. There's a new kid on the block, carbetocin, which is there. We have been using it. We've seen very good results. But I'm sure today Dr. Monica is going to deliberate on this and much more. And I'm sure all of us are looking forward to her talk. Can I have the introduction for Dr. Monica, please? Is the slide, will someone show the slide? Dr. Monica Gupta, I think everyone knows her. She's current secretary of AOGD. And she's professor at VMMC and Safdarjung Hospital. She's a fellow for urogynecology and pelvic reconstructive surgery with special interest in urogynecology and critical care obstetrics, where we are going to be listening to her today on that topic. Like I said, she's secretary of AOGD and has been secretary of NACHI earlier. She's been editor of ICOG FOXI yearbook, Obs and Gynae, and she's been the North Zone coordinator for FOXI. Dr. Monica, over to you.
Thank you, ma'am, for the kind introduction. I'll now share my screen. Is the screen visible to all?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So, before starting my talk, a big thanks to Sheba for having fill in, for me. Due to some unavoidable delays, and even more thankful to her to have covered, such a difficult topic on an elaborate aspect for the quality audit, and she practically kind of introduced and covered many aspects. So PPH in itself is such a vast topic that abridging it into both prevention management, abridging it into just 2 hours is doing no justification to such a vast topic. We all know that. So as of now, in my deliberation today, I'll concentrate on preventing PPH and what is, as Madam said, what all we have in our armamentarium available, and especially what new we should know about the available medical therapy for preventing PPH. And then probably we can kind of go on to transit that once it has happened, how to shift over to the eventual surgical management. So thank you, Meenakshi ma'am, once again, and I'll just start my talk. So to just give an overview, we all know postpartum hemorrhage is the loss of at least 500 ml of blood following vaginal delivery or 1000 ml following a cesarean section. And having said that, of course, it is unfortunate that still in the current times of so much of technology development and all, postpartum hemorrhage is still a common entity. And globally, if we see, 14 million women suffer from postpartum hemorrhage, and incidence of PPH reported worldwide is around 2-4% after vaginal delivery and 6% after cesarean section. When we talk about Indian scenario, the National Health Portal of PPH, National Health Portal India, PPH is still stated to be a major cause of mortality. And I will just take you through the figures. Uterine atony is the commonest cause, amounting to 50% of causes. And in this SRS survey, it amounted to you know, almost 30% of maternal deaths in the 2001-2003 survey. It accounted to 38% of maternal deaths. So definitely we should be knowing all on every aspect of postpartum hemorrhage. And why we are actually discussing it time and again is because of its, you know, widespread impact, which could be on, you know, the economy because of the increased, significant increased hospital stay, higher inpatient mortality, major impact on the lives and health of affected, and of course their families, and no denial of any long-term psychological impact on the affected women. This is an age-old teaching, but again, to reiterate for the benefit of postgraduates who are attending this session, is the etiology of postpartum hemorrhage. So here is the thing, that the four T's, the famous T's, tone, thrombin, trauma, tissue. And the tone most common being uterine atony, thrombin, coagulopathies, failure of any coagulation mechanism, trauma, uterine trauma, injury to birth canal, rupture of uterine inversion, lacerations, and in the tissue, retention of placenta and clots in abnormal placenta. And of course, still there's no denial in saying that amongst these all causes, the still the commonest cause is uterine atony. And for what we should be maximally prepared about, because rest all can be kind of predicted and you know, tackled. So amongst the risk factors, to so to answer one of the questions in the chat box, when to expect a, you know, massive blood loss, and when to be more prepared when we have these kind of conditions available in front of us, which is retained placenta, prolonged third stage of labor, settings of preeclampsias, multiple pregnancy, even the surgical intervention like episiotomies, previous postpartum hemorrhage or history, failure to progress in second stage of labor, any kind of arrest of descent or you know, dilatation of cervix, placenta accreta, we all know the very, very dreaded cause of PPH, and kind of anesthesias, complications of that, fetal macrosomia, perineal restoration, these all are the identifiable risk factors available. But we must remember that in low-risk populations having vaginal births, most women develop PPH who have not had any identifiable risk factors. So practically each and every birth we are catering to, whether vaginal or cesarean, please be prepared to tackle PPH. And in fact, better is to, you know, prevent it. So having said that, I'll not go through the details of this. We all know there are various categories of PPH, minor or major. Whenever blood loss is greater than 1 liter, it can be categorized into moderate and severe. And the basic signs, the findings which we should know of alarming signs in settings of PPH are abdominal tenderness, circulatory collapse, fetal bradycardia, increasing abdominal girth, loss of uterine contractions, maternal tachycardia, vaginal bleeding. And of course, there are various signs of degrees of shock depending upon the amount of blood loss which has happened. And very importantly, Dr. Shiva had highlighted that estimation of blood loss is a very, very important matter, and all should be, all tackling the deliveries should be able to estimate the blood loss, because, you know, what is being seen, there can be things even beyond that. So we should all be trained in estimation of blood loss very, very, very nicely. And of course, when we say we are diagnosing postpartum hemorrhage, we have to be having an initial evaluation with rapid assessment of patient status, which is like already things become even worse when the patient is already moribund, presence of tachycardia, hypertension, which are the clinical signs, assessment of vital signs of blood loss, as I said, depending upon the amount of blood loss, examination per se at the time of hemorrhage when it is actually happening, we have to quickly act and assess whether the patient, how critically ill the patient is at that moment. And of course, a very simultaneous, you know, starting of prophylaxis and management at the same time. And of course, laboratory assessment is important. So having said that, there are certain challenges in diagnosis of PPH, which we should be catering to be able to be more prepared for tackling postpartum hemorrhage, which is, of course, delay in diagnosis, visual estimation of blood loss, as I've already said. And whenever we are having settings of PPH without any identifiable risk factor, and of course under and over estimation of blood, which will affect the management accordingly. So alteration in any kind of vitals and flabby or atonic uterus should absolutely be immediately caught hold of and the management started. Complication associated with PPH, just in nutshell, it can be long-term effects like postpartum depression, anterior pituitary ischemia if it is a massive loss, anemia, fatigue, need for blood transfusion. It can be cardiac effects, dilutional coagulopathy, and even in settings of when we are late to act and inappropriately acting, which is not adequate, then maternal mortality. So what are the approaches for prevention of PPH? When we say, when we say approaches to prevent, it should be readiness by every unit, patient-centric recognition and prevention, and of course, once the hemorrhage occurs, the response to each and every hemorrhage occurring. So as regards the readiness, there should be immediate availability of medications, supply, checklist, very beautifully highlighted by Dr. Shiva, and instruction cards for hemorrhage. You know, we these days we are so much into this practice of checking again, the checklist, the availability, regular checkups within all the setups, whether private or public. You know, there should be there. There should be hoardings, or so to say, the display cards for the SOPs in management of PPH. The available armamentarium should be ready. This should not be availability of any outdated drugs. Proper precautions should be taken for storing and handling the equipments used for PPH. And of course, once it happens, or when you are expecting it to happen, availability of response team, which should be adequate enough, should be there. And massive and emergency release transfusion protocols should be in place. So preferably high-risk factor patients who are expected to be having postpartum hemorrhage should be delivering in facilities which have all sorts of tertiary care available. As regards patient-centric recognition and prevention, of course, there's no two ways about saying that there has to be a proper antenatal assessment of things like anemia, thalassemia, proper ultrasound checkups for finding out, you know, the at-risk patients, especially in the cases of morbidly adherent placentas, and high-risk delivery should be performed in facility with blood bank, as I've already said. Intrapartum management, the use of active management of third stage of labor, which I'll definitely come to in great detail beyond this. Avoid routine episiotomies and instructed deliveries. There have been various guidelines and WHO instructions in place. So judicious use of any kind of surgical intervention during deliveries. And of course, measure the cumulative blood loss and track postpartum vital signs very importantly. As regards response, having said that we are readily prepared, then that is the way we will be acting responsively and you know, immediately. So use an emergency management plan with checklist, which should already be in place in all your institutions, and provide support programs for patients, families, and staff. When we say practice of prophylaxis of PPH, things to be taken care of is the, of course, we need to take care antenatally with the hemoglobin aspect of the mother, identifying high-risk women in time, institutional delivery, strict vigilance for all women in third stage of labor. That is, of course, till the delivery part is not the end of the story. There is beyond, and now there is a fourth stage of labor as well. I mean, I'm not going into great detail, but all the stages of labor are important to be monitored. And active management of third stage of labor in all, examination of afterbirths should be a routine, and explore uterovaginal canal following difficult or instrumental difficult delivery. So even if we are prepared, and when we are prepared to tackle an emergency and it actually happens, the interventions which will be used for management of it would be first line treatment being administration of uterotonics. If oxytocin and other agents fail to stop bleeding, then there is the recent recommendation of using tranexamic acid as well, which can be used prophylactically also. And temporizing measures like intrauterine balloon tamponade, suitable for women who do not respond to uterotonics, or if uterotonics are not available, and it can potentially avoid surgical intervention in most of the cases and appropriate while awaiting transfer, which will be dealt in great nice detail in the subsequent section of the CAB. And of course, at the end, emergency services, if nothing helps, then we have to resort to interventions in properly equipped surgical, properly equipped centers. So coming on to active management of third stage of labor, preventing the PPH, the three cardinal principles of administering uterotonics with soon after the delivery of anterior shoulder, controlled cord traction to deliver the placenta, and uterine massage after delivery of placenta. Each and every obstetrician being trained or being practicing should be knowing these three tips. There's no two ways about it. And there have been studies world over, and very, very recent data, which is available in the stages of labor and birth, says that a WHO-directed multi-centered clinical trial has proven and highlighted the use of uterotonics as the most important aspect of active management of third stage of labor. Having said that, elaborating about the recommendations, it recommends the use of an effective uterotonic for prevention of PPH during the third stage of labor for all births, whether it is vaginal or cesarean. To effectively prevent PPH, only one uterotonic, recommended and preferred should be used. And amongst the armamentarium, we have oxytocin, carbetocin, misoprostol, ergometrine, oxytocin and ergometrine fixed dose combination. So these are all now recommended by WHO. Elaborating bit by bit on these uterotonics in slight more detail, WHO says that the use of effective uterotonic for prevention of PPH is recommended for all births. And as I said, this is the armamentarium. Now, within this armamentarium, what the recommendations are, the use of oxytocin is 10 international unit intramuscular or IV for prevention of PPH for all births. And skilled health personnel are required to administer it. And at the time of cesarean section, consider dividing doses and avoid a rapid IV bolus. What it says about misoprostol, misoprostol is either 400 microgram or 600 microgram can be given per orally, recommended for prevention of PPH of all births. And alternate routes may be needed at cesarean section, but oral route is preferred by women. There's no clear evidence of which dose is superior, but higher doses have more side effects. This has been practically seen. Inform women of possible adverse effects and can be used in hospital or community settings. Further, as regards use of ergometrine, 200 microgram IM or IV dose is recommended for the prevention of PPH in context where hypertensive disorders can be safely excluded prior to its use. Vaginal birth or cesarean section, skilled health personnel are required, and you have to inform the women of possible side effects. Other option may have better side effect profile. So practically speaking, in the current times, we are not practically using ergometrine as such. We are mostly using oxytocin and misoprostol, and of course now the new thing which is available, carbetocin. And as regards oxytocin and ergometrine fixed dose combination is recommended for prevention of PPH in context where hypertensive disorders can be safely excluded again. So wherever this ergometrine thing comes in, we have to be very, very particular about hypertensive disorders. Having said that, injectable prostaglandins are another available modalities, but they are not recommended for prevention of PPH. They are the modalities which have been recommended for eventually management of PPH once it actually happens. So amongst the use of uterotonic agent, the approved molecules now are oxytocin, carbetocin, ergometrine, sintometrine, and misoprostol. They can be administered at crowning of baby's head, at the delivery of anterior shoulder, at end of the second stage of labor, and following the delivery of placenta. When used for prophylaxis, help in prevention of PPH, and they are important aspects of AMTSL. Therapeutically, they can also be used in management of PPH. So amongst this available armamentarium, at this forum, of course, and in our settings, of course, carbetocin, as Dr. Meenakshi said, is the new kid on the block. And amongst our preparedness, once we need to start it, we need to know more about it, because it has been much less covered topic as such till date in PPH in our kind of setting. So I would like to just take you through this implementing updated recommendations for the WHO thing. We must first ensure that, do we have skilled health professionals who can administer injectable uterotonics available with us? If, and then second thing is oxytocin available? Third thing we have to make sure is oxytocin of sufficient quality? That case, we use oxytocin 10 international units IV or IM. If answer to any of these things is no, then a trained community health worker and lay health workers are allowed to use things like misoprostol, which is 400 microgram or 600, as I said, per orally. If oxytocin is not available, then what to do? Then, if the quality cannot be guaranteed, both the things, that case comes the options of a heat-stable carbetocin, which can be given as 100 microgram IM or IV in context where its cost is comparable to the effective uterotonics available. Or the other option, as I said, is ergometrine, where we have sufficiently ruled out hypertensive disorders, or fixed dose combination of oxytocin and ergometrine again, or misoprostol. So this is a nutshell, the preparedness chart which we must have, which can be implemented for all the deliveries. Amongst the available evidence, what we have is that when carbetocin was compared against either oxytocin or sintometrine after delivery, vaginal delivery or by cesarean sections in the Cochrane collaboration, where we had 11 randomized controlled trials compared, which included 2,635 women, it was found that there was no difference in the risk of heavy bleeding when both of these things were compared. And women who received carbetocin were less likely to require other medications to produce uterine contractions following cesarean section. So in a way, when the safety profile was kind of comparable and the risk of bleeding was comparable, then of course an agent which would eventually prevent the use of other agents would be preferred. This came out through this collaboration. And when carbetocin versus sintometrine was compared, it was found that carbetocin had less blood loss compared to sintometrine and less likely to experience side effects such as nausea and vomiting, which is more common with sintometrine. Another Cochrane review only, which said uterotonics agents for preventing PPH meta-analysis was done in the year 2018. This was published in 2018. Eventually, compared the side effect profile, adverse effects, and it was found that ergometrine plus oxytocin combination or misoprostol plus oxytocin combination had an overall adverse effect profile more as compared to carbetocin or oxytocin being used alone. So again, as regards safety profile, carbetocin and oxytocin were comparable. So having the available evidence, what leads us to decide which one, identifying a uterotonic of choice, when we have to head-to-head compare the available armamentarium through oxytocin as a common comparator, because that's the most commonly used uterotonic with us. And the natural sequence for introducing a new uterotonic option is to evaluate the efficacy with gold standard option already available. So that is our crux of eventually comparing the effects and profile of the new kid on the block, which is carbetocin. So I'll take you through carbetocin in much greater detail. When we compare head to head all the uterotonics which are available to us, this is a very busy slide, I'm sure, but in a nutshell, it shows the comparison of dose and route, the onset of action, side effect, and contraindications. So when we head-to-head kind of compare oxytocin and carbetocin, we see that the things like hypotension, ischemia, arrhythmias are kind of missing from the carbetocin side effect profile. And but the contraindication here for carbetocin are uterine, vaginal, or cervical rupture. And as you can see, the onset of action is also kind of delayed, 2 to 4 hours after IV injection, but IM injection is 6 to 120 minutes. Whereas overall for oxytocin, whether used by IM or slow IV, the onset of action is 15 to 30 minutes. So we have to take care of...
Not onset, duration, Monica. You're reading it wrong.
Sorry. The duration of action. Onset of action is comparable for both the two. Thanks, ma'am, for correcting. It's just a slip of tongue. So onset of action is kind of comparable, 2 to 3 minutes or 2 minutes for both of them. So we have to take care of all the characters of the available uterotonics with us before we use one or the other, one over the other. When we say the challenges available other than carbetocin with the available drugs we have, we must remember that oxytocin, with the use of oxytocin, there is need for appropriate trained staff, of course, to administer it. There's no two ways about it. And there is mostly a requirement of other uterotonics agent when the things are not able to get controlled with single one. In sintometrine and the combination of methylalbumetrine, again, I've said we have to take care of the blood pressure. And when oral misoprostol is being used, there is a high risk of severe PPH, increased need of additional uterotonic agent, and greater risk incidence of nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, and shivering, which we have very commonly seen, even the rise of temperature. So why this drug was carbetocin is being talked about is because of its fewer modifications over oxytocin, which makes it more, which prolongs its half-life a bit more than oxytocin, and of course reduces the enzymatic degradation. And it is a synthetic long-acting analog of oxytocin. And as regards administration and the available formulation, one vial contains 100 microgram of carbetocin and 1 ml of solution of injection. As regards mechanism of action, it receptor binding triggers the activation of phospholipase C and generation of second messenger IP and diacyl glycerol. Eventually leads to release of free calcium from intracellular stores. And this eventually is causing the uterine smooth muscle contraction by activation of myosin light chain kinase. So a single IV dose of carbetocin, which is 100 microgram, administered after delivery of baby, is sufficient to maintain adequate uterine contractions, preventing uterine atony and excessive bleeding, with efficacy comparable to hours of oxytocin infusion, which may be continuous. Just a brief about key pharmacology. Half-life is 45 minutes, bioavailability is 80%, and mechanism of action we've already discussed, but the pharmacokinetic properties of carbetocin allow for its use as a single bolus dose use, and just as effective as oxytocin. Why the rationale of development of carbetocin is the most important aspect as regards storage and use in all your settings is that carbetocin is available in a room temperature stable formulation and convenient vial presentation vis-a-vis oxytocin. Because heat stable formulation of oxytocin is currently not available. And previous formulations of carbetocin should be stored at 2 to 8 degrees, but currently resource poor countries do not have cold chain transport and storage availability. So now there is a room stable formulation available, and that is why this thing is being now talked about in greater detail as compared over oxytocin. This most of it we have already discussed. This was a very important trial between oxytocin and carbetocin, which was the WHO champion trial. And it kind of proved the non-inferiority of carbetocin as compared to oxytocin when the outcomes considered were the proportion of women with blood loss at least 500 ml or the use of additional uterotonic agents. And the other criteria which was studied was proportion of women with blood loss of at least 1000 ml. So when they were compared head to head, they found that in the first category where blood loss greater than 500 ml greater than or equal to and the use of additional uterotonic agent, the non-inferiority was definitely established. But when it came to blood loss of greater than 1000 ml blood loss, it was eventually, the trial was found to be underpowered for its outcome because of the less number of patients eventually available in the trial who actually had a blood loss of greater than 1000 ml. So, and the adverse effect profile did not significantly differ. So it was a comparable safety profile. Thus, the frequency of blood loss of at least 500 ml or the use of additional uterotonic agents with carbetocin was proven to be non-inferior versus oxytocin. And the use of additional uterotonic agent intervention to stop bleeding and adverse effects did not differ significantly. Eventually, it was concluded that carbetocin was non-inferior to oxytocin for the prevention of blood loss. So having the comparable safety profile with the formulation, which is kind of heat stable, has been advocated that carbetocin can better be used in our settings to prevent PPH. And as regards other studies, there have been many studies available. Carbetocin decreases the need for uterotonics versus oxytocin. Another trial published very recently in 2020 proves the same thing again. And it said even the those kind of similar result that as compared to oxytocin and the need for additional uterotonics was much lesser in carbetocin. When we say when there were randomized controlled trials comparing carbetocin and oxytocin, this is kind of slightly older study, but with the same result, there was lesser incidence of PPH in carbetocin group, lesser blood loss in carbetocin group, and lesser number of patients treated with carbetocin needed additional uterotonic compared to oxytocin. As regards elective cesarean section prophylactic treatment, again, compared to oxytocin, prophylactic treatment with carbetocin was found after an elective C-section was found to have a reduced need for additional uterotonics by more than 50%. So practically, we have available evidence both for vaginal delivery and cesarean delivery for the lesser use of additional uterotonics in the prevention and management of PPH. Further studies, same thing, but here carbetocin was demonstrated to have similar efficacy to sublingual misoprostol plus oxytocin infusion for prevention of PPH. So having told you about the available evidence, what are the recent recommendations world over about carbetocin? It has been included in the essential medicine list by WHO now and recently approved in Switzerland for all types of delivery. In India, it has been approved by Central Drugs Standard Control Organization, which is CDSCO, under the Directorate of Director General of Health Services, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, very recently on 21st September 2020. And that is why it is being talked about in so much great detail that this is a new thing which everyone should be knowing, and has been approved specially for, mind you, prevention of postpartum hemorrhage due to uterine atony. Various other societies, SOGC, Danish Society of Obstetricians, National Center for Health Technology Excellence in Mexico, all have approved the carbetocin in the IV dose of 100 microgram in 1 ml given over 1 minute. These are other further societies who have approved this use. And this is in nutshell saying that in 2018, WHO included carbetocin in the essential drugs. Canada again says 100 microgram IV bolus. Even RANZCOG in New Zealand has approved it for active management of third stage of labor. FIGO, one of the recommendations for PPH management as carbetocin, and FCOG France again. So various societies world over, various organizations, the guideline forming organizations have now approved the use of carbetocin for preventing uterine atony. Thus, as regards preparation for PPH, when we have talked about all the measures for preventing it, this is the there's no two ways about saying that all those aspects are important. But amongst that armamentarium for the new thing, which is carbidopsin, the take home points would be there is evidence to suggest that 100 microgram of intravenous carbidopsin is more effective than oxytocin for preventing PPH undergoing cesarean deliveries. Carbidopsin is associated with significant fewer side effects compared to sintometrine in the prevention of PPH for women who have vaginal deliveries. But still, having said that, it's a new kid on the block. Further research is needed to analyze the cost effectiveness, which is, mind you, the major factor for carbidopsin as a uterotonic agent to be used at large. So this is all I have from my side for this presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Monica. It was you had, I think, given all the key messages in a very wonderful and a very capsule form. So it was a very, I think, thorough review of carbidopsin versus all the other uterotonics available today with the evidence base. And I think most of us are now convinced that carbidopsin is something very effective for prevention of PPH, and many of us have started using it also. So one thing which I wanted to ask you, that there was one slide in which you mentioned, you know, if there are a lot of anxiety because it's a new drug, about what are the contraindications and what are the side effects. So what, you know, normally we don't know much about it. So in one of the slides, you had written that uterine rupture, vaginal and cervical rupture is a contraindication. So this is like, you know, I feel that for uterine rupture, if you suspect, any uterotonic is a contraindication. You are not going to give uterotonics if you are suspecting a rupture. Naturally, we are going to then do some other action. You have to do the laparotomy and open the patient and do something. So basically, that point was not very clear to me, that what it means that uterine rupture or cervical rupture or vaginal, you know, it is a contraindication. Plus, there are some other, you know, thing issues like whether, because it has a sustained action. So normally the oxytocin has an action of up to 30 minutes, but this has an action of up to 4 hours. So again, there is little bit of anxiety about giving it to patients with high risk, you know, factors like heart disease, for instance. So if we give it in a case of heart disease, so, you know, because that period just after delivery is very critical. So will it cause, you know, a lot of very sustained contraction and auto transfusion of blood? Can it lead to failure? So I think these are the things which have to be, you know, maybe further on research will make these things more clear. But definitely in the low risk women, I think it is a wonderful drug. And it should be used. And as you very rightly said, that any delivery can have a PPH, because really, you know, it is very difficult to predict that who will have PPH. Besides those who have got the risk factors, majority of cases who end up with PPH have no risk factors. So doing the active management of third stage is actually the need of the hour. And I think every one of us obstetricians should follow that very sincerely and use the drug which is available for us easily. And definitely, I think it is worth trying carbidopsin in our daily practice. So this is what I wanted to comment.
Actually, Jyotsna, the recommendations which are given by WHO are all for low-risk women.
Prevention
in low-risk women. They have specifically said these are the drugs which can be used. For all other disease, they have to be individualized. That's why the recommendation are not, you know, for everything.
And your I think that is very important, ma'am, that message.
I think your raising this point is very important, that everybody should know that we are talking about low-risk women in general and should not be using it right and left.
Yes.
Till we have more evidence.
Yes, ma'am. Mm-hmm. So for low-risk women, I think that is what we are key message here, that we should try and use this molecule for the low-risk women, and then we wait for more evidence in the different subsets of the high-risk patients. before.
As of now, ma'am, yes, a very, very valid point raised by you. And in fact, that should be the message as such, which should be put across at this particular moment for whatever available evidence we have. But one thing is definitely for sure that the heat stability, that's the main factor they are all who are now promoting carbetocin, and with the available evidence, it says that nothing, not much has to be done regarding the storage factor, which is a very important thing in most of the centers, one thing, and the comparable safety profile, of course, for the low-risk patients. But as you very rightly said, because of its prolonged effect on various high-risk patients, what is going to be the outcome and all, that is yet to be seen. And we really need more studies. And once this thing starts getting used, maybe that is the only opportunity when we actually get to know what is the effect.
Monica, can I just make a comment?
Yes, you know, ma'am.
Yeah, so it's definitely a wonderful new agent for us. And we might find it to be very, very good also and switch over to it. But when they talk about heat stability, they are talking about heat stability at 30 degrees Celsius. So
yes,
if our cities or in our country, look at Rajasthan, somewhere where the temperatures are much higher,
ma'am.
You know, it's it will remain, it will not be effective for as long. So
it is being transported, you know, to maintain that 2 to 8 degrees, very difficult to maintain 30 degrees
easier. It's much easier.
For transport, 30 degrees is easy, but for use and storage, 30 degrees may not be possible unless the room is air-conditioned. So, you know, you may have warmer months, and then you will have to know that it... so, it's got different 30 degrees.
Geographical issues, yes, ma'am.
Kept at for 3 years. If it's 40 degrees, it can be kept, I don't remember, but I think it is for maybe 1 year. If it's higher temperature still, then it's only all right for 1 month. So we have to remember that it's not only the storage and transportation, but where it is housed, where it is kept. And there is no harm. I wanted to have you throw light, or maybe Dr. Jyotsna, Dr. Achla or Meenakshi, that if we say we procure carbetocin and we keep it at 2 to 8 degrees, there's no harm.
There's no harm, ma'am.
But it should not be frozen.
Yes, yes.
ये नहीं है कि हम सोचे कि बहुत सारा stock मंगा के freezer में रख दो. So that won't do. So you should keep it. We can keep it in the refrigerator, because most of our labor rooms will have refrigerator. And why take a risk of 36 degree temperature and have this in doubt that it's an expensive, relatively expensive, and why it didn't work? So we should look at this logistic part as well.
Personally, I could add something, like,
yes,
thank you so much. Excellent and very, very comprehensive talk. And like I said at the outset, that the more we talk about PPH and the more strategies we can devise, of course, it's fantastic to have one more value addition to the armamentarium of the, you know, uterotonics. But I still feel that with the added advantage of carbetocin, the temperature regulation, etc., but I personally feel that if we have a very good step one medication already, AMTSL with cyntrocinone, which has got a very good safety profile. So I would say that let's keep collecting data. And still I would say that instead of keeping it as the first line carbetocin, we should keep it as the second line. Like, because you never know in which patient the cyntrocinone doesn't work, and then at least you have another medication.
But
to
Dr. Mitra, carbetocin is not to be used for PPH as yet. So there is no
I know, but you know, Dr. Achila, but I'll tell you what, with so many talks around and Abbott and all the companies pushing carbetocin, and in private sector, see, every obstetrician is so scared ki kahin PPH na ho jaye. So now, ab shuru se hi carbetocin lagate the. I mean, that's what I would like, that you people should convey this again, that it is very good, but it should be still kept at the second line.
No,
not
but Dr. Mitra, that's what I'm saying. There's no second line. It is either of the drugs. Either you use oxytocin or you use carbetocin. There's no second line for prophylaxis. prophylaxis is only single drug. Okay. You use but, only one. The only
but, Dr. Achila, if oxytocin that, is doing so well as the
then one the option. only issue with oxytocin was not where it is being used. It is from it has a long travel history, and this that travel. They have found, they have done studies, even the Ministry of Health has done studies, and they found more than 40% of the samples of oxytocin which came, they were not of optimal quality. That is the reason that oxytocin is being less used than carbetocin, because we don't know the travel history. So that is why 40% samples they found were not optimal. It's not that carbetocin is better than oxytocin. They are both equal.
And the one advantage
we have that one, it is, at least 2 to 8 is not required. Second is that in a low-risk patient, if you can cover those 4 hours, the fourth stage, where you have to really look after the patient, she may have PPS. So sometimes you require continuous oxytocin in those 4 hours. Instead of that, if you give carbetocin, you will not have to give that.
Yeah, and one more advantage is that it doesn't cause hypotension.
Yes, ma'am.
The way the oxytocin IV, there is a risk of hypotension.
But I think in very soon we will have good data to actually back up, because
that is the main.
अभी क्या है ना कि आप लगा दोगे, but suppose अगर किसी patient को फिर भी PPH होता है.
Dr. Mitra, you see the data is of more than 25,000-30,000 patients, which data has been shown. Of course, we have to make our own data.
Yeah.
But
India
was part of that champion trial.
Yeah. And once WHO gives the nod. WHO gives a nod. I don't think it gives it very easily. They have very stringent criteria. So
may I add something?
Can I add something, please?
So I was also skeptic about the molecule, just like what we are discussing. I was in touch with one of the doctors who was part of the champion trial and who is now using it in his nursing home on the outskirts of Thane in Mumbai. And he told me it's a wonderful molecule. Let's be very clear about that. It's ranging from between 200 to 400 rupees. I don't think it's expensive. And I think when it starts coming into the mainstream, it will become even more cheap. It is only for prevention. Once you have PPH, the PPH drill, whatever we are doing, stands true even today. So there is no, it's only for prevention. Yeah. And like Dr. Achila correctly said, that batch to batch oxytocin differs in various places. Even in good hospitals, you find that your oxytocin batch to batch effectiveness may vary. So here we have a molecule whose batch is going to be the same, is effective for preventing PPH. It's not for treatment at all.
Yes, ma'am. That is what is being advocated, only for prevention as of now.
It's only for prevention.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
India is not like in only urban side. India means rural, urban side. Both. There are many PSCs, many sub-centers where carbetocin is one modality of treatment for prevention. One modality for prevention. Even if misoprostol is available, that too can be used.
What happens is that fact of the matter is that for last 15 years or even more, I am using oxytocin and I have my protocol that the cold chain is maintained.
If oxytocin is very potent,
actually satisfied. In fact, for last 5-6 years, I have not used misoprostol at all. And that is 100% no use. I have not used. So I'm saying this, of course, we have to have our own experiences. And of course, this is a fantastic molecule.
Yes.
There's no debating it. And the knowledge gained.
That means if oxytocin is available and it is stored properly, it should always be used as a first drug of choice for prevention.
That's what I showed in that
Dr. Mitra, Monica showed it very clearly that oxytocin, you are confident of the quality of oxytocin. Yeah,
exactly.
We are all agreeing with that it's a very small chain
that I have an ice box in my labor room. Every time when the second stage patient comes in, only that time the ampules are taken out from the
Dr. Mitra, everybody is not you. Not bad. Everybody is not you.
Unfortunately, everybody is not you.
We have a choice now. That is all. We have a reasonably good choice.
I think we should go ahead now.
Thank
you, sir.
We have the video session.
Thank you, Dr. Mitra. Thank you for being here.
Thank you so much, everybody, for the wonderful inputs. I think it was a great discussion. So now we hand over to Dr. Meenakshi for continuing the video session. Thank you. Thank you all.
Dr. Shivani.
Dr. Shivani.
Thank you, Dr. Monica Gupta, ma'am. It is always a pleasure to hear you speak, and it was a very enlightening talk on preparedness of PPH, and it was very precisely summed up by our experts. Now, I'd like to go on to the video session, in which the experts, I would like to introduce the experts for the video session. First is Dr. Achala Batra. She is head of unit at Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology at Safdarjung Hospital. She's president Nalchi Delhi chapter 2018 to 2020.
Let's not waste time on me. Yeah, next step.
Dr. Shashi Ilata Kabra Maheshwari, ma'am. She has organized more than 50 workshops on PPH and seems to be the apt person to go to for this topic. She's an MEB faculty and resource person, chairperson multidisciplinary committee AOGD 2020-22, chairperson PCPNDT committee West District Delhi. She has been a peer reviewer of Journal of Jyoti and
SCA. Thank you so much.
Lastly, our expert, last expert for the evening is Dr. Leena N. Sridhar, Lieutenant Colonel. She has been she's a senior consultant at Manipal Hospital, Dwarka, and is head of department academics and research of the hospital. She's an alumni of Maulana Azad Medical College. She did her post graduation from Safdarjung Hospital, followed by her senior residency.
Thank you.
She has also served the.
Carry on, please.
Thank you, ma'am. Now I'd like to introduce the experts, introduce our first speaker for the video session, Dr. Akriti Batra. Dr. Akriti Batra is senior resident, Department of Obs and Gyne, BMMC and SGH. She's a life member of FOXI, AOGD and NALCHI. She has been a silver medalist in paper presentation at International Critical Care and Obstetric Conference in 2015. And she's published various articles in state and national journals. And secondly is Dr. Soumya Mahesh. She's senior resident, Department of Obs and Gyne, Safdarjung Hospital, member of AOGD, FOXI, IAP, ISCCP. And she's also participated in workshops and has participated as a delegate in various AOGD conferences. And she has a special interest in reproductive medicine and infertility. Welcome, ma'am. I would request you to start the session.
Hi everyone, I am Dr. Akriti Batra. I'm a senior resident at VMC and Safdarjung Hospital, and I'm going to be talking about various balloon tamponades, which act as a transition between conservative and surgical tampons in people. Balloon tamponade in atonic PPH is a very effective method to control bleeding refractory to. It puts inward pressure of the wall of the uterus, which is more than the systemic arterial pressure, to control bleeding. So WHO has made certain recommendations on use of uterine balloon tamponade for the treatment of PPH due to uterine atony after vaginal birth in women who do not respond to standard first-line treatment, provided the following conditions are met. Immediate recourse to surgical intervention and access to blood products is possible, is needed. A primary PPH first-line treatment protocol, that is use of uterotonics, Tranexa, IV fluid, is available and routinely implemented. Other causes of PPH like retained placental tissue trauma, they are excluded. And the procedure should be performed by a health professional who are trained in the management of PPH. Balloon tamponade and maternal condition can be regularly and adequately monitored for prompt identification of any signs of deterioration. So the commonly used balloons are condom balloon catheter, Chhattisgarh balloon catheter, Bhakri balloon, and the Ilavi balloon. So first I'm going to talk about the most common one, which is called condom balloon catheter. This was made in Bangladesh. It is very easy to make. We take a Foley's catheter, usually number 24 is used, and a rubber catheter, a condom is put over it, and we tie the mouth of the condom with a silk thread or a rubber, which we take out. Then it is filled with 200 to 300 cc saline, and its end is closed by tying with silk, and vagina is packed with gauze to keep the balloon catheter in place. Next is the Chhattisgarh balloon. It was designed by Dr. Nalini Mishra, and it is also made with Foley's catheter and condom. I'm going to demonstrate how it's made in the video further. It has the advantage over a normal balloon catheter that it has an outflow tract for blood collected inside the uterus, which is not possible with a normal Foley's balloon catheter. Then we have the Bakri balloon. Bakri balloon is a ready-made balloon catheter, which is made up of elastic. So there's no chance of leakage, and it is supplied with a 60 cc syringe. It has two channels, one for inflow and other for outflow. And it takes very less time as it is ready made, and it takes less time to fill as well. It easily adapts to the shape of uterus and has a valve inflow channel to facilitate filling and draining as well. And the last one is the Ilavi balloon. It is a new innovative balloon. It has four parts, a container of 1,000 of 200 as you can see, with markings, a elastic balloon, and a sliding lock over the tubing. The fluid is filled from the container to the balloon in the uterus, and when the atonicity recovers and the uterus contracts, the fluid starts contracting, and with the rise in the intrauterine pressure, the fluid turns back from uterine balloon to the container. The pressure in container can be decreased or increased by adjusting the height of the tube. I'll be demonstrating this in the video further. So what all is required to make a normal balloon condom catheter? We need a Foley's catheter number 24, condom, silk, scissors, saline, drip set, two sponge holders, sim speculum, a betadine pack, and a bowel and a kidney. So how do we make a normal condom balloon catheter? We roll the condom over the Foley's catheter and tie it with silk, or put a ring of Foley's at a distance of about 5 to 10 centimeters, depending on the size of it. And we put a three-way at the end of tubing, which is optional, or we can directly connect the IV drip set. And then after we fill the catheter, we block the tubing after. It's a Chhattisgarh balloon. So in this, we can cut two rings from the end of the Foley's, as you can see. And the balloon, the Foley's is inflated from this end. After inflating the balloon, we burst the balloon. We slip a condom over it. And we the two rings which we had cut, we tie the first below the eye. And the next, same as the condom catheter, 5 to 7 centimeters. After that, so this would act as and then after that the catheter is ready to use. Now after putting it, same as the condom catheter, it is inflated through the opening from which the balloon was filled. That is this opening with the blue. It's inflated by a 50 cc syringe, and since it has one-way valve, the fluid does not come out while you remove the syringe and take another one. So in this video, it's been demonstrated how a condom catheter and Chhattisgarh catheter is made. First, we are making the condom catheter, sliding the condom over the 24 number Foley's, and we are going to tie it with the silk. This has only Yeah, it's ready to use. Now we connect the IV drip set, and it's very easy. Next one is the Chhattisgarh catheter. Now we are inflating the balloon. Rings out of the Foley's, we'll burst the balloon. We'll After that, pull the condom over it. Tie it with strings, one below the eye and one pipe. Cut the eye. Check it once that if it's. The next we have is Bakri balloon. It is a ready-made balloon. It is commercially available and it is made up of elastic. Then it has two channels, one for outflow and one for inflow. The inflow channel has a two-way valve. The balloon is inserted the same way as we did in the prior ones, Chhattisgarh balloon tablet. This Bakri balloon, we have been supplied with a 60cc syringe through which we can fill approximately 500cc. But if the balloon is visible at the cervix, we can stop filling the balloon. So as soon as you see that the balloon is visible at the cervical end, that means it is adequately filled. And then you pack the vagina. Rest of the procedure is safe. So now I'm going to demonstrate insertion and removal of balloon. So we clean and drape the patient. We retract the vaginal wall, hold the lip of cervix with sponge holder, hold the ready condom catheter with sponge holder and insert it in the uterus till fundus. We do not hold the condom part with sponge holder as it can weaken the condom. And we try to use two condoms because if in case one bursts, there's another one. A simple condom balloon hangs line at 1.5 meter and run the drape. Keep holding the catheter with sponge holder and keep looking at the cervical opening. When balloon is visible, stop filling, remove sims and pack the vagina tightly with wet pack. Close the end of the Foley's and balloon catheter with silk or rubber band made from Foley's. When patient is stable after balloon tamponade and no bleeding is seen, that means it's effective. After 12 hours, deflate the balloon to half of its capacity and don't remove the pack. And wait for 1 hour. If patient's vitals are stable and she's not bleeding, then we can remove the pack and deflate it fully. Then after that, keep monitoring closely for next 4 hours. Keep oxytocin on flow and give single dose broad spectrum antibiotics. This is the video in which we're going to demonstrate the balloon catheter, the catheter and the Bakri.
Now I will show you.
There is no sound.
No
Kriti, you can give a running commentary.
PP, also the abdominal height, which you marked in the beginning, and every 1 hour you keep monitoring if there is collection of fluid inside the uterus, the fundal height improves. If patient remains stable, everything is all right. After 12 hours, you start removing the fluid. For removing the fluid, what you have to do is, whatever you have used to close this port, you open it and drain half of whatever you have fluid you have put in. If it is 300, remove 150 cc. Do not remove the pack. Wait for 1 hour. If patient remains stable, there is no bleeding, then you can remove the pack. And after having removed the pack, you can remove the catheter also. After removing the catheter also, you have to monitor the patient for 4 hours for bleeding PV and vital. For putting in a Chhattisgarh balloon, the procedure is same of putting inside. Only thing is, this cannot be done with the drip set. You will have to do it with the 50cc syringe. So you take 250cc syringe while you are filling the balloon with one, the assistant will fill another one, and this has to be put from this end, not from this outflow end. So this way you can fill it, and then rest of the procedure is same. For Bakri balloon also, the procedure of putting is same. It has the advantage that it has a two-way lock. So you put in a 60cc fluid from the syringe and then close it, take another 60cc, and when you have to empty it, you just open this valve and fluid will come out. So this is the way you have to put in these balloons. And
yeah, so after the balloons have been put in, we have to constantly monitor the patient for pulse and BP and to check for bleeding every 15 minutes for the first 4 hours, and as well as the urine output. When patient has stabilized, then after 4 hours, we can hourly check the patient for the next 12 hours. The height of the uterus has to be checked hourly in a simple condom catheter, because in this, the bleeding is occurring inside the uterus because it may collect inside till its amount is large and the pack is soaked. Therefore, if the fundal height starts increasing, it's a sign of collection inside the uterus. So it's very important to check for uterus height when we are using a simple balloon Uli's tamponade. So the last one is the ILAVI balloon. It is a new innovative balloon. As I told earlier, it has four parts. The bag, the tubing, and the balloon, and the valve. So the step one is we close the valve and fill the container to 1000 cc. Then we hang the container at a height of 1.5 meters. We hold the balloon in one hand and insert it in the uterus, keeping the other hand inside the uterus at the cervical opening so that the balloon does not slip out. Then we open the valve. It takes around 1 minute for the balloon to fill inside the uterus, and fluid will stop going in when balloon has filled the uterine cavity. After 30 minutes, we check for the BP and adjust the height of the tubing according to the systolic BP. We leave the balloon in situ, and when the uterus will contract, the fluid will start going balloon to the bag. Water moves freely between the balloon and the bag as soon as the pressure in the uterus is more than the it will make the fluid push from the uterine balloon to the bag. This provides a visual indication of improved uterine contractility and facilitates faster balloon. Adjusting the vertical height of the bag controls the pressure between the balloon and the uterus. This pressure needs to be slightly higher than the pressure in the uterus to stop bleeding. When systolic pressure is low, height of reservoir bag is increased, and when it rises, it is lower. Length from the balloon to mark on tubing. So if the BP, systolic BP is less than 80 meter, then there's I'll be demonstrating it in the video. There's there are four marks on the tubings. So if the systolic BP is less than 80 millimeters of mercury, then the length of the balloon to the mark on tubing should be 1.60 meter. And if BP is 80 to 100, then it should be 1.30 meter. And if it is 100 to 120, it should be 1.60. And while putting an ILAVI balloon, we should advocate antibiotics for 5 days. This is the video demonstrating how to put Gavi balloon.
Put the sound also.
This is little different from all the balloons you have seen. This has three parts. This is the container in which 1000cc saline can go. It has a lock, which is a sliding lock, which can be opened and closed like this, and you lock it. So I am locking it. You can see it is locked, no opening is there. Then you fill it with either a clean water or saline. You fill it to the 1000cc mark. You can fill it directly from a saline bottle, or if you have taken, you can fill it. This is not totally full, but the principle is that you fill it to 1000cc. And then you hand this at height of 1.5 millimeters. When you hang it at 1.5 millimeter, now you can see these are marking on this. 1, 2, 3. I'll tell you why these markings are there. So when a patient is having atonic PPH, you have prepared your ILAVI balloon. Similar way, the same speculum is used to retract. The anterior vaginal wall is held with sponge holder. Then you put in the ILAVI balloon. And after having put in, you can slide it up. Then ask the patient assistant to remove the speculum and the sponge holder. Now, what you have to do is, your head is still inside. You ask your assistant to open the wall. So when the valve is open, this balloon will start filling. You can see how rapidly it is filling. So it will keep filling till the pressure in the balloon and the pressure in that bag equalizes. Then it will stop filling. After it stops filling, you wait for half an hour. After half an hour, you take the BP of the patient. Now if the BP of the patient is 80 millimeter of mercury, at that time you have to keep it at this level. The tubing should be at this level. Can you make it higher? This is the height. We can't show you, but you have to make it higher. So tubing is at this level. And if the BP is 100, then the tubing will be at this level. If the BP is 120, then still balloon, this container would be at a lower level. And then you watch the patient keep taking pulse BP every 15 minutes. When the patient stabilizes, the bleeding decreases, then after 8 hours, you have to again see whether you want to remove it or not. But as the uterus will contract, what will happen is the pressure inside the uterus will increase, and this will compress this balloon. And the fluid will start going from this balloon into that bag. This can't be shown here because we don't have a live uterus. But as the uterus will contract, you will know that the uterus has contracted, fluid will start going back. At that time, you can remove the bag from the height and put it at the level of the patient. So what will that do? That will make the fluid start coming into the bag automatically. Now we put it at the level of the patient and the bag will start filling. You can see the fluid has started coming into the bag automatically. So when the balloon gets emptied, you remove the balloon. If you have to transfer a patient, what you do is that you fill the bag, fill the container to 1000 ml. And open and fill the balloon
and after that you close the valve. Here we have never closed the valve, but for transfer you close the valve so that whatever you put inside the uterus remains inside the uterus, and when the patient reaches the destination then you open and hang it at 1.5 meter. Then after half an hour, according to the BP, you adjust the height of this tubing. So this will better in a way that it tells that how much fluid has to go. For Bakri balloon or other balloons, we put in the fluid empirically. When this, the exact amount of fluid goes in and compresses upon the surface of the uterus. It can also be used for a sandwich method when we are doing a cesarean. You can put in this balloon. Now I'll show you when if you are doing a cesarean, how you have to put in this these balloons. So what you do is, from the cesarean incision, you hold it with the help of a sponge holder, and then you take it inside the cesarean. Come this up. And there is an assistant at the vaginal end who will pull the balloon out once it has gone. So it pulled out, pull it out, and then the upper part is put inside the uterus, and then you close the uterus and inflate it later. Because if you will close the inflate it and close the uterus, what will happen is you might puncture the balloon. So you inflate it after you have taken the first layer at least. So this is how it can be put, and this has helped to reduce the bleeding tremendously and save many a laparotomies. And I hope I have made it clear to you how the balloons are made.
I would like to conclude that balloon tamponade can act as a transit between conservative and surgical management in PPH, and it's a very effective method. Thank you.
Stop sharing. Can we have the next presentation now?
Hello. Hello.
Yeah. Can you see?
Yeah. Now we can move on to the next presentation. Non-pneumatic anti-shock garment, and this is a new addition for the treatment of postpartum hemorrhage, especially those patients who are in shock. And you know that 90% of deaths due to PPH occur in low and middle income countries, in areas where nearest health facility with comprehensive obstetric care may be far away. And same condition is prevalent in many parts of our country too. So these deaths can be prevented with timely and effective maternal healthcare management and equipment. And this NASG is fit for the purpose device that can save women's lives through reducing blood loss by as much as 50% and stabilizing the women until procedure is available. So I invite Dr. Soumya. She has already been introduced, and I request Dr. Soumya, please elaborate on NASG.
Good evening, everyone. I hope my slides can be seen.
Yeah, it is seen.
So I'll be talking about NASG, or it is known as non-pneumatic anti-shock garment. This is a pictorial, I've taken this from WHO slides, and this is what an anti-shock garment looks like. As we all know that obstetric hemorrhage is the leading cause of maternal mortality, especially in the developing countries. So one of the vital methods to manage PPH is by the use of a non-pneumatic anti-shock garment, or NASG. It is a comprehensive support system to stabilize the patient which might be any patient, especially who's under hypovolemia due to obstetric hemorrhage and shock. It is actually a crucial first aid management in hypovolemia due to PPH. Where is it being used? As you can see, this is again being taken from WHO documents. It is actually being used almost all over the world, and it is being used predominantly in both developed and developing countries. So 10,000 women over 33 countries have used this anti-shock garment over. So NASG is a lightweight neoprene garment that is made up of 5 segments that is closed tightly held with Velcro. The correct application of an NASG garment will supply 20 to 40 mm of millimeter of circumferential pressure to the lower body, affecting reversing the hypovolemic shock, which can be due to PPH. So this is an NASG garment, which we can see, and this is the patient. The NASG has basically got 6 parts. Basically, it has 1, 2, and 3 parts over the lower limbs, and this is on both the limbs. And the 4th and the 5th part, and the 6th part will override the 5th part. So this is over the abdomen. The mechanism of action of NASG is basically that what happens in PPH is that the patient will be losing blood. So the patient will be in hypovolemia. So what it does is that it compresses over the vessels, over the lower limb and the abdomen, and it will basically provide blood to the important parts in the body, especially towards the brain and the heart, so that the patient will be able to maintain a state of normovolemia. So in shock, the brain, heart, and lungs are deprived of oxygen because blood accumulates in the lower abdomen and legs in addition to the loss from the vagina due to any obstetric hemorrhage. So this circumferential counter pressure, which will be reversing shock by returning blood to the vital organs, as I already mentioned, decreases blood to the compressed areas, and overall it decreases the blood loss. So what is the application of an NASG? The NASG garment has to be placed under the woman. That is the first step. We close the segments, one tightly around the ankles, the closest second on both the ankles, close the second segment over each of the calves. The third segment is over the thigh, and it leaves the knee free. The fourth segment is around the pelvis. The fifth segment is as a pressure ball over the umbilicus. And once we finish closing the NASG garment, the fifth segment will be overrided by the sixth segment. So segment 1, 2, 3 can be applied by 2 persons, but segment 4, 5, 6 should be applied by 1 person because we can increase, or the overall pressure can be increased, which may not help in the proper functioning of an NASG garment. The uppermost portion, segment 5, should be just below the ribs. The lowermost portion of segment 5 should be above the pubic symphysis. And the patient should be comfortable while taking a deep breath in the NASG garment. The vaginal procedures which we can do with NASG in situ is any pelvic examination. Lithotomy position can be maintained. The repair of episiotomy wound, perineal tear, vaginal tear, any traumatic PPH, any laceration, cervical tear. Manual removal of placenta, again causing PPH. Bimanual compression can be given. Any DNE, DNC, and MBA can also be done. With this NASG garment, we can even do abdominal procedures like laparotomy by just keeping the segments 1, 2, and 3, which are basically over the calves and the below the level of the pelvis, so we and the thighs. And we can open these pelvic and abdominal segments 4, 5, 6 just prior to the insertion. We need to operate quickly because the 4, 5, 6 segments have to be replaced after the procedure. The future challenges are that NASG is actually not a one-size-fit-all PPH tool. It normally comes in 3 sizes, which have been developed to accommodate a significant population dependent over the various anthropometric variations over the world. But in India, most commonly size would be small because the build of the Indian woman is actually smaller. But in Nigeria, they found that extra large sizes were also desired to accommodate the women in that particular region. There is no accurate tracking for the number of uses and cleanings, but approximately the reusability has been defined for around 75 times. Now I will just show a video of the NASG garment.
She was been nice enough to pretend as a patient, which is actually aap yahan letenge.
Okay, ma'am. So this is a
pneumatic anti-shock garment.
You can see it is made up of neoprene and it has a lot of velcros on it to tie. So what you do is that when a patient is going in shock, you have to put it under the patient. Aditi, will you come this side and lift the patient's legs? So you slide. As if patient is cautious, you ask her to raise her leg. Apne hips uthaiye.
Hips
uthao, iske niche uthao. And you slide it under the patient. Right? After you have niche uthaiye, and you have to check that you have correctly put the garment under the patient. For that, you have to see the leather. So you can see there is part 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. So before you start applying, you have to see that 6 is at the level of lower legs and this is at the level of umbilicus. So you don't start applying before you see this. Assistant, when you are putting in, so first what you do is you put in part 1. This is the velcro part, so non-velcro part goes in first tightly. And over it, you put the velcro part. It has to be tight. So you check the tightness. The sound should be there. Then, again, the non-velcro part as tight as possible. And then you put the velcro part. Again, you check. It should make a sound. Now you put in the section 3. So when you put in the section 3, you should see that the knee of the patient is free. The first was put over the ankle, the second was put over the calf, and for the third, you put over the thigh, leaving a space for the knee. Again, after this, you don't, two people don't do, a single person should do, otherwise you can put in extra patient. The part 4, again, the non-velcro part is taken and this is should be at the level of the lower part, should be at the level of the symphysis pubis. So again you have tied part 4. So we have this area pair. Then part 5 at the level of umbilicus. Again the non-velcro is put first, then you put in the velcro part. So now we have put in, a patient is ready for transport. Because she was in shock, putting this will take the blood from the lower limbs and the pelvis to the upper part for lungs, heart and brain. So patient can be transported in this position. And then we have left this part bare because this patient wants to pass urine. So you can just ask her to fold her legs and just, you know, fold this portion a bit and a backpack can be put. When the patient reaches the center or in OT, now you want to do a vaginal procedure. So just patient can be put in the lithotripsy position and the procedure can be done. Suppose patient requires now laparotomy. Still you keep the garment on, you remove 6, 5 and you remove 4. Clean and drape the patient, perform the surgery. After performing the surgery, again you put this 4 and 5 back. Now, after 2 hours of patient being stable, means her BP is more than 90, her 90 systolic and her pulse is not more than 100 and the bleeding is not more than 50 ml per hour, you can start removing So how do you remove is, again, the way you had put. You start removing from one. Then take the BP of the patient and see the pulse. So if the BP of the patient does not fall below 90 systolic or the pulse does not rise above 100 in 15 minutes time, then you remove part 2. Again, take the BP of the patient, take the pulse. If the pulse is not more than 100 and BP is not less than 90 systolic, you remove the part 3. This way you remove each part after 15 minutes. Similarly, you do for fourth part, take the pulse BP. If they remain stable, then you remove and then a patient can be off. This is a little correction from what was given earlier in the WHO compendium, that there was a rule of 20. For each segment, it was written that the pulse should not rise by 20 and BP should not fall by 20 millimeter of systolic, but now a correction has been made. So any fall in BP or any rise in pulse, you should put the segment back. Thank you, Vijayalakshmi. Thank you for helping us.
Okay.
It has to be driven. Now this garment has become dirty, it has to be cleaned. So with the brush, you remove any tissue is there. Then you take the garment and wash it in a sink with water. After having washed it, then it can be put in a washing machine or you can wash it in a tub. But before washing, we have to decontaminate. For decontamination, the washed garment from the sink should be put in a hypochlorite in a big tub and with 0.01% hypochlorite in it. And because this is light, so there is a tendency for the garment to float. So you have to put something heavy over the garment. After 15 minutes in hypochlorite, then you rinse it and then wash it in a washing machine or otherwise. Now after having washed it, you don't dry it in washing machine, you hang it to dry. And after it has dried, you have to fold it. The folding also has a technique, otherwise it will get spoiled. Otherwise a single garment can be used 75 times. So how you do folding is that now you don't want the Velcro to stick. So what you do is, you put in the Velcro portion here and non-Velcro portion come on the top. One, again, you first put in the Velcro portion, this portion is on the top. Here again, Velcro and this on the top. Now, after having done this, you fold it like a mat. Fold it like that, take it here and put it back. Now, again, now you will put in the section 4, again the Velcro portion first, then this. Then this 4 goes like this. And then this 5. Here you will want to stick it because you want to keep it safely. So you put the Velcro portion. Now our bag is ready to be kept in a place for using it. Using the NASG has decreased the maternal mortality in areas where there was a delay in transfer. So while you have put in the NASG, it will keep the circulation to the vital organs and protect the patient. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Excellent video presentation. Excellent. Ma'am has covered everything and it was very important that part 1, 2, 3 requires 2 persons and 4, 5, 6 only by 1 person.
Yes, ma'am.
And it is very useful for the transport of patient or if the patient is waiting for operation.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Welcome.
Thank you, Dr. Shashilata Kabra, ma'am, Dr. Soumya Mahesh, and Dr. Akriti Batra. And thank you, Dr. Achila Batra, for the wonderful videos. They're very informative and gave us a new perspective to management of PPH and the preparedness regarding it. Now I would request Dr. Priyanka Pante to take over for the question answer sessions, audience interaction, and for the vote of thanks. It was a great pleasure to be a part of such an event, which will help to reduce the maternal morbidity and mortality, which is a major issue for our country and also all over the world in low-income countries. Thank you, everyone. I would like to call over Dr. Priyanka Pante for further carry forward of the talk.
Good evening, everyone. It was a privilege to be among such eminent personalities attend the wonderful lectures today. We have two questions in the chat box. One of them is comparison of LRV balloon with other catheters, cost and its efficacy. As per what I can see, it costs around $7.5, nearly 500 to 600 rupees. And it's available online, available in India.
It's not that cheap. not all that cheap. It okay. is 2,000 to 3,000, but much cheaper than the Bakri balloon.
As per a study, there was a comparative analysis of user experience in 2020 by Harvard Library. It shows that ILAVI has been rated as the simplest, easiest, and the fastest one to use. The average time to assemble it, apply it, it was less compared to the other catheters, the Bakri catheter, the Every Second Matters, ESM UBT. So that's what I could find, ma. It was cost effective also. But rest, ma'am, I would hand over to you for further expert opinion.
No. If there's any questions, the effectivity is same. Only thing is the advantage is that we know exactly how much to fill in, and we know we can remove it earlier. You know, once you start contracting, we know that fluid has started going back. It means the contractility has returned. With the other balloons, we have to wait for 12 to 24 hours. In this, we can remove it earlier, as we can see. So it has been found to be quite effective.
Thank you, ma'am. If any of the other seniors would want to give their expert opinion regarding the same or add on. That was the only question, ma'am, that we have already covered.
Then you can conclude the session.
The previous question was covered in Monica ma'am's lecture. Yes, ma'am. I would like to hand over for the vote of thanks, ma'am. And it was a great experience and a privilege to be here today. Thank you, everyone.
You, both of you conducted the session very well.
Thank you, ma'am.
Lots of hard work has been put in making these videos.
So, I guess it was a very, very fruitful and, I would say comprehensively discussed webinar. And most of the common queries, and thanks Dr. Achla ma'am to pitch in for the Government of India directives for this new drug which has been talked about. And first thanks
for the study, Monica, in which they have shown.
It was, yes ma'am, and the contention behind it, why there is a comparison between the two drugs. So thanks to you, ma'am, as always. And Dr. Shiva, very, very nice and elaborative talk, as we've already said, and thanks for pitching in. And to all our experts, Dr. Shashi ma'am, Dr. Leena, and Dr. Rajyoti had to leave earlier. Dr. Sanjeevni ma'am, Dr. Jyotsna ma'am, Dr. Meenakshi ma'am, for all their expert comments. And of course, to top it all, Dr. Mitra Saxena for giving her very, very valuable comments and the practicality of the things available. And I thank Shivani and Priyanka for being wonderful MOCs and helping us at back end. And Soumya and Akriti for wonderful video presentation. And of course, last but not the least, all the audience who is still sticking with us for this very important and informative session. And of course, Abbott Pharma, who was the academic partner for us in this CME. So thanks one and all once again. And thanks, Shashi ma'am, for being with us till the end.
Thank you. I enjoyed
it. Thank you, everybody.
It was a complete comparison, PPH.
Thank you, ma'am. Achla, ma'am?
Oh, no. I think everything has been covered. I've been speaking in between. I think now we can, call it a day. You know, PPH, I can never stop talking about
exactly.
PPH.
Exactly.
And Shashi can never stay away from... And Shashi can never stay away from BPH.
Yeah. Yeah.
I must say, Shivani, out of being a new MOC and whatever, she used the appropriate words. The go-to person for BPH is Dr. Shashi. So Thank you. Actually had you with us, ma'am, today. Thank you one and all once again. Thank you.
Thank you.